Hello, my name is Pastor Chris Aaron Rice, and I am so thankful for the opportunity to come with you and to dig into God's Word about Christmas, the very first Christmas, the historical background of that, and how we can learn about how to get through hard times like the one we are in right now. But first, let's go to the Lord in prayer. Heavenly Father, we thank you for sending your Son to die on the cross for our sins. He was born just like we are, Lord. He suffered some of the same things that we suffer every single day. We thank you for the ability to turn to your Word, to learn from it, to grow deeper in our relationship with you. Be with us during this time. Thank you, Lord. In Jesus' name, amen. Today we are going to be turning into the book of Luke and Matthew. We're going to be digging into the story of Christmas. Now, Christmas is a special season in the United States and around the world. I'm sure as I say that word, pictures of Christmas decorations, sweet foods, and big presents are popping into your head right now. In the U.S., Christmas is supposed to be a time of joy. Movies and music, cards and presents are used to reunite families and good friends. Whether you're religious or not, Christmas is a special time of year. But why do we consider it special? What is the religious significance of Christmas? And how did the original audience view the Christmas story? This year, Christmas is going to look different. Answering some of these tough questions can help put the holiday into perspective and get us through this trying time. Christmas is the time where Christians normally celebrate the birth of Jesus Christ. Who is Jesus? In the Jewish religion, God had promised his people, Israel, a Messiah. This person would redeem Israel and draw them back to a right relationship with God. He would come from the family of Jesse, born in the line of David. And this king would come to rule the world with justice and grace and mercy. The prophet Isaiah says, "There shall come forth a shoot from the stump of Jesse, and a branch from his roots shall bear fruit. And the Spirit of the Lord shall rest upon him, the Spirit of wisdom and understanding, the Spirit of counsel and might, the Spirit of knowledge and the fear of the Lord, and his delight shall be in the fear of the Lord. He shall not judge by what his eyes see, or decide disputes by what his ears hear, but with righteousness he shall judge the poor and decide with equity for the meek of the earth." That's Isaiah 11, 1 through 4. Jews are still waiting for their Messiah to judge the world with equity and the Spirit of the Lord. Christians believe that Isaiah is talking about Jesus Christ. When they read this passage, they take joy in the fact that Messiah has come to righteously judge the earth. Now, the Christmas story takes place with scriptures like this in the backdrop. God promised his people a Messiah who would come to release Israel from bondage. Why does Israel need to get released from bondage? Well, Israel went through several different points in their history of being persecuted and enslaved by other countries. When the Jewish people heard this synagogue, this passage read out in the synagogue, they would have felt hope from relief from some of their enemies. Between Isaiah and Jesus, several different peoples enslaved the Israelites. They were exiled to Babylon for their disobedience to God. Isaiah and Jeremiah and Ezekiel are speaking directly about the Babylonians who will come to inflict God's wrath on the people of Israel. Now, after 70 plus years, they moved back from Babylon to Jerusalem and started building the second temple. Alexander the Great, though, came and conquered most of the known world. And when he died, his empire was split up into four different kingdoms. Now, the Seleucid Empire ruled most of Persia and also Jerusalem. And a lot of these rulers were very Hellenistic, meaning they believed in Greek culture. That's what Alexander did. He started persecuting all other religions other than this Greek way of life. And the Jews really, really loathed that. They hated being persecuted and repressed from following their religion. And so, at about 180 BC, before Jesus Christ was born, they revolted. And you have the Maccabean Revolution. And this was the first time that Jerusalem had experienced some form of independence all the way back to David and Solomon. And these rulers used Rome to help them conquer the Seleucid Empire. And Rome, in return, set up puppet kings like King Herod the Great and Agrippa, all of these kings who said, yes, I'm an Israelite, but their loyalties were directly to Rome. And Rome started taxing the Jewish people again. And so Jesus is born in this time of incredible political tumultuousness, political upheaval, and the Jews really, really hated their oppressors. And so when they heard these passages read aloud, they had hope for a Messiah that would come and free them from bondage. The Jews won several battles, and they declared independence, and then the Romans came in, and again, they just started oppressing them. And the Israelites, by that time, had probably forgotten all about the Messiah, or they thought it was just a fairy tale. But Jesus fulfilled these prophecies in ways that no one expected. We read in Luke chapter 2, 1 through 7, in those days, a decree went up from Caesar Augustus that all the world should be registered. This was the first registration when Quirinius was governor of Syria, and all went to be registered, each to his own town. And Joseph also went up from Galilee, from the town of Nazareth, to Judea, to the city of David, which is called Bethlehem, because he was of the house and lineage of David, to be registered with Mary, his betrothed, who was with child. And while they were there, the time came for her to give birth. And she gave birth to her firstborn son and wrapped him in swaddling cloths and laid him in a manger because there was no place for them in the inn. Now, Caesar Augustus ruled right after Julius Caesar from about 27 to 14 AD. He may have ordered the registration to be able to tax all of the families within his kingdom. Joseph had to travel to register in the town that he was born in. He probably hadn't been in Bethlehem in decades. And Luke gives us some important details about the circumstances that Jesus was born into. The idea that the Messiah, the Savior of the people of Israel, coming from Bethlehem, this tiny little town of no importance, was ridiculous. The Messiah should come from palaces, not mangers. He should come with great power and wisdom and wealth. This is the kind of Messiah that the people of Israel thought they needed and that they expected. Who do you hope for this season? Do you have hope for a brighter tomorrow? It's hard to focus on celebrating Christ's birth when there's so much going on around us. You see, Christmas is a special season, but not for the reason society makes it to be. We celebrate the birth of Jesus Christ, but do we stop to think about the circumstances he was born into? Angels and wise men, shepherds, a king, fear and death surround Jesus being born. And we're so very far removed from the danger and the wonder of that early morning. Sitting around a colorful tree full of glass ornaments and presents, we must work hard to find common ground between now and then. Many of the Jews had lost hope of ever hearing or seeing the Messiah. But Jesus entered the world at a critical moment, shattering all expectations of what power is. Jesus was a homeless immigrant, fleeing for his life from political oppression. when the wise men came to visit Jesus, they spoke to King Herod the Great. They innocently shared their mission of following a star that they believed would bring them to the King of Israel. Herod, being shrewd and deceptive, asked them to let him know when and where they found the baby, so that he could pay homage or meet him too. After the wise men left, Herod ordered that any baby boy under the age of 2 be killed around the area that they had indicated. Joseph and Mary were warned in a dream by an angel to flee to Egypt. The very first Christmas was not a happy time, full of presents and good cheer. Yet out of the weakness, fear, and darkness of that morning, the Son of God entered the earth. I'm so thankful that I know that Jesus can relate with suffering. Imagine if things had been different. Imagine if Jesus had been born in palace with all of the other nobility. What if he had not suffered the temptation in the wilderness or been forced out of towns for preaching the ministry, the gospel of God? What if Jesus experienced wild popularity, fame, and wealth? What if he didn't die on the cross, but instead died in a golden coffer? I don't think you or I would even know his name. The truth is, God works through brokenness and hardship. Jesus came with a meek and submissive spirit, not bold and strong as was his right. Jesus related with sinners, and even though he himself was blameless, I'm so thankful that Jesus came as he did, not strong as the world is, but suffering as I do sometimes. This year is going to look very different from previous holiday seasons. There are loved ones we're not going to be able to see in order to keep them safe. The economic impact of COVID-19 means that there are fewer presents under the tree this year. Many have to isolate alone to keep themselves and others safe. There is so much suffering in the world right now, and in the midst of all of this suffering, there is opportunity to love others well. In this season, let's remember the suffering of others as we ourselves feel the pressure of these hard times. God works through weakness. Throughout the Bible, God reveals how he uses broken men and women and turns them into tools for their kingdom. Abram was nobody special before he answered God's call to become a pilgrim. He grew wealthy on the journey, but only because he trusted in God's strength and not his own. David was a poor shepherd boy, born last in a large family. He rose through the ranks of Saul's men by leaning on God's providence and guidance. All of the judges were broken and fallen people, but God used their gifts to bring his people back to him. The prophets were not mighty men who enjoyed wealth and fame, but instead, they were cast out and abused by their very own people. See, God still used them to draw his people home. God does not need human strength, fame, or recognition. He uses normal, broken, sinful people like you and me to accomplish his will. The story of Christmas is a story of brokenness. Jesus, the Messiah, the very Son of God, came from humble origins. He knows the suffering the world is going through right now. This gospel, this good news, is for everyone. We read in Luke chapter 2, 8 through 14. In the same region, there were shepherds out in the field, keeping watch over their flock by night. And an angel of the Lord appeared to them, and the glory of the Lord shone around them. And they were filled with great fear. And the angel said to them, "Fear not, for behold, I bring you good news of great joy that will be for all the people. For unto you is born this day in the city of David a Savior, who is Christ the Lord. and this will be the sign for you. You will find a baby wrapped in swaddling clothes, lying in a manger. And suddenly, there was with the angel a multitude of the heavenly host, praising God and saying, "Glory to God in the highest, and on earth, peace among those whom he is pleased." You see, God is pleased to reveal his plan to the humble hearted. God came to save all people from the chains of sin and death. The sign he gave to the shepherds is the same one that we celebrate every year. A baby born to a poor family was born in a place where animals ate food. The message of this salvation is not for the mighty, most knowledgeable people. It's not for the self-righteous priestly class. It's not for the people who think they can do it all by themselves. This message is for people who recognize their need for God to save their soul. You see, Jesus didn't appear first in the temple. He didn't appear first in the government buildings. He wasn't born, as was his right, as a king with everything provided to him. No, he was born to Mary and Joseph, who were nothing of nothings, and in a place where everybody disregarded a little tiny town. He was born in a cave. They didn't even have a place for him to rest. He was born and laid in a place where the animals ate their food. Have you ever thought about that? How God revealed his plan of saving the world through humble means, not through greatness as the world sees it. Out of weakness and humility, God saves the world. John and Abby lost their jobs during the lockdown earlier this summer. They both had pretty well-paying jobs with nice house and two cars. The industry they worked in got hit majorly throughout the lockdown. Most of their coworkers got laid off along with them, and there were no promises that the job that they had was waiting for them after the lockdown. They had three children between the age of 10 and 18, and they struggled really hard throughout the summer to provide just for the basic needs. Unemployment was not enough to cover all of the cost that they had, and the overwhelming bills just kept piling on. Friends and family were not able to help, as they were struggling through a lot of the same things that they were. Soon, Abby and John had to choose between eating food and paying the bills. They thought before all of this happened that they had their life together. They thought that they had enough in savings, that their debt wasn't crippling, that they could handle life. But when a pandemic locked down everything around them, they found out that they really were relying on themselves. They found themselves with no savings and no help. John and Abby will struggle to celebrate Christmas this year. And the truth is, there's a lot of people like John and Abby right now. There are many people who were in much worse of a place before this pandemic began, and now it's even worse for them. They are experiencing homelessness or a level of suffering and poverty that they never thought they would. Now, the holidays are a time when we like to throw on a happy face. We like to build up our facade and pretend like everything's going right in the world. It's going to be hard to do that this year. This year is going to be really different, and you have an opportunity to make this hard year something wonderful, even in the midst of the hardships. I believe that COVID-19 can remind us why we celebrate Christmas. Believe it or not, we don't celebrate this holiday for the presents. This season of danger and confusion and hardship looks a lot closer to the first Christmas than it ever has before. Like that fateful day we are experiencing a lot of political turmoil in our country. Everywhere we turn, it seems that hate is spewed by one side of the political aisle or the other. The Jews did not sit well under Roman rule. They didn't like the oppression that they felt, the taxes that were heavy on their people, and the level of control that the Roman Empire laid on their shoulders. Right now, the global economy is in the tanks, and many are fleeing for their lives to somewhere safe. Remember, Jesus was born into a poor family and was forced to flee for his life to a foreign land. So on the first Christmas morning, the angels of the Lord delivered a message of salvation to a bunch of humble shepherds. This message is the same today as it was then. The Christ is born. God revealed his plan of saving all the people through one humble baby boy. No amount of delicious food, beautiful lights, or expensive gifts can compare to God's gift to his creation. So in this season of hardship, let's get back to the roots of why we celebrate Christmas in the first place. One of the best ways to celebrate Christmas is to love others well. Encourage your family or friends by reaching out to them and extending love. You might not be able to go and physically see them. Give them a call. Write them a note. Send them something that you know they'd appreciate. Remind people the good news of Christ's birth, that something good can come out of the brokenness. Your love is a powerful agent for change. The best present you can give someone today is the good news that Jesus Christ is born. He died for our sins and he loves us. No amount of brokenness or sin is too large for Christ's sacrifice. There are so many people who are hurting. And I really want us to remember that as we do meet with our close family or intimate friends, as we keep our groups smaller and smaller because of COVID-19, we still have the ability to be agents of change in our community. Give what you can to others, because what's going to happen is you will change your own heart and your own perspective of the hardship that you're experiencing right now. And you will also change the perspective of someone else. There are lots of people who do not believe that Jesus Christ is the Messiah, that Jesus Christ was born. For them, Christmas is just a time for materialistic goods. But you know what? If you loved them well this season, they might be prepped to hear the message that the angels gave to the shepherds. You might be preparing them for a life-changing decision of accepting Christ Jesus as their Lord and Savior. Now, during the hardships of the world, everybody is looking at the church to see how they will respond to this critical needs that everybody is experiencing. How is the American church going to respond? Is it going to sit back, hole up, build walls, pretend like nothing's happening? Or is it going to step into the mess, get their hands dirty, pray, send gifts, send love and encouragement to other people during this time of need? There are so many ways to help others right now. And because of COVID-19, we have the opportunity to love others well in a way that we don't generally get that chance. So I want to remind you, Jesus Christ is born. We have every reason to rejoice in that fact that God, out of brokenness, healed the world through one humble baby boy. This Christmas season is going to look different, but I know that we can make this season a season of change for better. We just have to step out and trust God that he is working even now through this brokenness. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Father God, we love you so much. We thank you for your word. We thank you for revealing the brokenness and how you work through it to make change for good. We love you and we need you now. In Jesus' name, amen.
as Reverend Rice and the staff of NLEC ask Jesus Christ to strengthen them through the power of the Holy Spirit, you also can do the same. If you've never committed your life to Jesus Christ, you can do that now. Just ask Him to forgive you for all of your sins and to be your Lord and Savior.